Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, to the Dota 2 Champions League season number 11 coverage of what is now round of 8 action, our quarterfinals here in the single elimination tournament. We are now in best of threes, and things should start getting really good here in the Dota 2 Champions League. I'm Breaky CPK, going to be joined by my co-caster Z-Rock here, and we got Penta Sports going up against Zoken Gaming here in our first best of three to kick it off here today. Excited to be here, Z-Rock. Good morning.
Absolutely am. I'm fantastic this morning. How about yourself?
Doing pretty good. I woke up a little bit ago. I got my coffee going, and I'm ready to cast some entertaining Dota here. And, you know, we got Zoken Gaming on one side, who, frankly, From what I'm recalling here, I remember them as one of the more sound teams, actually, in that first round best of one matchup. So this should be a good one here with them and Penta Sports going at it.
Yeah, I'm really curious to see how this all looks now that we're going to have BO3s, because we kind of had some crazy best of ones going on.
Yeah, that's without saying. I mean, the results were interesting. I think that's a good way to put it. Really, majority of the matches you could value as upsets here if you had to lean towards one team or the other going into it. I think maybe even 6 of 8 of the matches probably were considered upsets in that first round. But again, that's best of one format for you, and that's what happened. And these two teams were involved in said upsets, you can call it, but deservingly so being here at the same time. Penta, actually, they're here because they defeated the former Friends team. Okay, see, this is what's throwing me off. Wow. Okay. It just all came together, Z-Rock. I'm looking at the bracket right now, and I'm like, wait a second, how are these teams matching up? But I didn't really think too much about it. But now I'm looking back at it again. So Penta, this is a team that was just known as going in. They were going in literally like a couple of days ago, and they just officially announced that they joined Penta. So that's right. This is the former going in team going up against Zoka. Okay, so yeah, this should be good.
They got a sponsor.
Yeah. There we go. Because Penta, the former Penta team, they actually lost in their first round. So that's also what's kind of confusing to me. Now I'm looking back at it. Okay, I'm sorry, Z-Rock. It's like I said, it's still early in the morning, but we're making it happen here. All right. Anyways, we got a draft underway. We got Rubik Juggernaut for the side of Penta here, and Slaughter Dazzle on the side of Zoken. What do we got here? 5 seconds
remaining. Yeah, I mean, Slaughter definitely a very premium pick still, although he's been getting nerfed. He just doesn't seem to quite go away. Juggernaut being picked up, so we'll get to see that nice gaudy Arcana in action. Should be a little bit of fun. But the one thing I do want to point out is we've seen these super defensive supports starting to come back with a vengeance, especially the Dazzle. It's done very well so far in this tournament, and I think we'll see it continue to do well, provided they draft a team with some major damage around it.
Yeah.
And there's options galore. I would love to see a Shadow Fiend come out for Zoken in this round, in the second phase of this draft here. And I hope Penta doesn't get caught up in the same trap when you pick a Rubik early and then you pick a low damage roaming support, like we saw the Rubik Earth Spirit combo fall flat a number of times. So I hope they end up drafting a little bit of damage as well. I think a lot of these teams are prioritizing so much control anymore over the actual damage they're going to be able to do. And then if a game goes to 40 or 50 minutes, which I think is a lot more of a reality in this patch, they kind of just all of a sudden don't kill anything anymore.
Something we got to be concerned about, obviously, with picking Radiant up some heroes. But I'm also looking at the initial bans right there as we're going over the whole recap of the event and everything. But those initial bans on the side of Penta Sports, you got the Visage and then the Io on top of it. But the Visage is the one that really stands out. And I had to clarify on this as well, but we did see that mid Visage play in the first round, Zoken against actually No Logic Gaming, it was. And oh my god, did it wreck. It absolutely wrecked. It went 13-1 and 13 in that game. The middle matchup itself, he did very well. It was a lot of fun to see. So clearly Penta Sports paying a lot of respect to a hero and in a position that really we haven't seen, especially as of late, here with Zoken, prioritizing a ban on it. So yeah, very intriguing to see that. With the
That's one I think might be getting slightly overbanned just because new patch hype, somebody did well with it in this tournament, which made it very visible. But we'll have to see long-term if that actually holds true. Visage has come and gone in the meta, but it's either been fully enforced and, like, this is first pick material, or it's never seen. Reserve
time. Yeah.
So there are very few teams that just kind of run it. But we'll have to see here shortly.
Yeah, it's a respect ban, and we're going off of just that one game. So I kind of agree with you. If you're Penta, maybe you do let it go the first game and then see how you deal with it, being a best of three now. But they do priority ban it, so it's done. It's taken away. They get Axe on the other side, and now Tusk coming out for Penta. All right, that's a little different. Get the Ice Shard trap, though, sets up Juggernaut spin pretty well.
Yeah, it really does. We saw some awesome Tusk play when the Earth Spirit was getting banned out a lot, where in the qualifiers, he just showed how versatile that hero can be. There's so many different ways to use Ice Shard, Snowball. Literally, every one of those skills has multiple uses, and I hope we get to see something like that again. And with the Darkseer pickup, it's incredibly potent. Ion Shelling a Tusk is one of the most dangerous things in the game, because Tusk has so many ways to sit on this Zoken lineup. There's Snowball, there's Ice Shards, there's Sigil. All of it helps you just sit on top of them. And when you couple that with an Ion Shell, it can really put a ton of pressure. So the question is going to be, is this a dual offlane? Or are they going to wait, let Darkseer get like level 5, where the Ion Shell is really doing damage, and then bring the Tusk in?
Yeah. Curious to see that too. But, I mean, as far as the middle or the short lane option for Zoken Gaming here, that one position most likely, still don't know who that's going to be just yet. They have everything else pretty set in stone. The TA course, mid, Axe, more than likely in the offlane, perhaps a little bit in the jungle if it comes to it. And then Dazzle roaming as supports roaming even on top of that. Perhaps, again, depending on how the lane's set up. But Penta, they're looking for their mid option, knowing now that TA is going to be the pick here.
We may be starting to see the era of Drow come back slowly but surely. We'll have to see. But Penta banning it out with their last ban. I'm a bit surprised to see Penta's Lifestealer ban, honestly. This would have fit their lineup perfectly. Yes, it could have fit fine in Zoken's as well. But the thing is, Penta gets first pick. I think they could have ran a mid jug and then run Lifestealer as their carry. But, oh man, I'm excited for this. So the Venom mid was ran in the Chinese qualifiers for, what tournament is it?
It was for the DPL, was it?
Or was it the
Manila Masters? It was one of those tournaments, yeah.
I believe it was DPL. I think it was DPL. So either way, that is going to get picked up, and it dominated every game it was picked. So we'll have to see if our Euro boys can use it in the same way the Chinese did. But this mid-Veno would go stuff like Mjolnir and Hurricane Pike and Blink Dagger and just be a mobile right-clicking Veno, basically.
Yeah.
And do a ton of damage. And it shreds through Refraction. So the TA doesn't really get the TA benefit in lane because you've got so many dots and plague wards hitting you that it's a bit rough. So definitely a counter matchup here, and Penta should have the laning advantage in pretty much every lane.
Yeah, that's a good point to bring up. The matchup itself is definitely making it kind of stand out to me a little bit more. But so I will say this. I know exactly what match you're talking about, and it just absolutely shined in that specific one. And in general, it's actually being started to be picked up in the Chinese region over these last couple of days. It's kind of like, it's kind of the trickling effect. But I did get the chance to cast it a couple of times early in the morning yesterday for what was the DPL itself, actually. It was the following day, even, I think it was. And we saw it twice there, and both times it honestly didn't do that well. It kind of fell behind a little bit early on, and then you can kind of tell a little bit of the weakness of the hero as a result. So as long as you get that good start, though, and maybe if you're looking to be team fighting quite a bit, which no doubt Penta Sports has capability of doing, then definitely it could be a powerful pick. But curious to see, how it obviously transitions here. And again, it's a hero that more and more people are clearly starting to pick up now. As I said, that trickling effect. Bloodseeker, the final pick on the other side. So that's a fun fifth pick on either side coming out right here to finish off. Why the Bloodseeker, are we thinking? All right, wait, you're muted, I think. I do not hear you at all. I see your green circle going off. Nope, still nothing. Wait, oh, that's on my end? Hold on.
10 seconds remaining.
That's so weird. All of a sudden, you just got muted. No, it's looking like mine's fine. Let me try rejoining the call.
Are we back?
There you go. God, that's so weird.
It was on your end.
GG Discord. All right, anyway. So, yeah, Bloodseeker final pick. What the hell's going on here?
I wish I could tell you. The only games I've seen of Bloodseeker, I saw Complexity run it with that 4 role that Z-Freak played. It did some work, but it did end up falling to Onyx in the major qualifier.
That was me, though, to be
but,
fair.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, that is fair. But he tried. The one thing that really sticks out to me is the fact that Penta's lineup is super tempo-based. If they fall behind, it's going to be really hard for them to recover. Darkseer needs to get a decent laning phase and get that mech arcanes up by like 12, 13 minutes. We've seen what happens to a Juggernaut that falls behind. The only one I've seen recover was super split pushing, and I don't think he really gets that option with a Lifestealer and an Axe in the game.
Yeah.
So we'll have to see what this Bloodseeker goes, because when you run it as a support, the options are flexible, right? If you want to go carry items, you can. If you want to go damage items, you can. You can even go this utility Bloodseeker where you go like Yule's Force Staff. But as a Wanderl, as your hard carry, it gets a little more interesting. So I'm excited to see it, but I think there were better options.
What about this, though? Because now, the kind of playing mind games here, and like, is it possible that Zokin's maybe going to send TA as a short lane and then Bloodseeker middle? But then TA's having to deal with the Darkseer with the Ion Show, which seems just as effective against the Refraction. So I don't know. Would that even make sense then?
I just don't think you can put the TA anywhere but mid. She needs a really short lane to make use of Psyblades effectively. It just may be one of those things. To be honest, she doesn't max or fraction first. I would doubt it, but it's just one of those rough lanes. I don't think there's any good situation, because as you said, Ion Shell destroys it, Jug Spin destroys it, Venno destroys it. Like, refraction just doesn't exist for the defensive capabilities for the TA in this game.
Yeah. Hold on, though, because this is so weird, though, because Bloodseeker, he's getting an Iron Talon. As far as he has a recipe for it in his early build, I was thinking, are we going to see something like a Dazzle carry even? And him jungle? But no, Slaughter has got boots first, so he's going to be more of the roaming support as expected, so it is going to be a core Bloodseeker here.
Yeah, I think the idea is your Bloodseeker gets level 3, level 4, gets up an item, an Iron Talon, like Phase Boots Iron Talon, what he has on his Quick Bite. Then he falls into the jungle and lets Slaughter get his blink. Bloodseeker jungles incredibly quickly.
Okay.
It's one of the top 5 junglers just for raw clear speed. So if he wants to do that route, it does go a little bit greedy, but I think it benefits him in the long run. I was talking last time we casted about how I think supports that can jungle are getting more priority right now.
Oh yeah.
Because the game's just a little bit slower, it's going to be a little greedier, and offlane got so much harder. So I think this is a good way to go, where your carry jungles, because they jungle faster than some of these supports that were picked up. But yeah, we'll have to see.
Here we go. It's gonna be an aggressive offlane from the side of Zokin as Dazzle's actually coming down here. This has cutting the creep wave written all over the Dazzle Axe combination. But when you're going up against a tri-lane like this, I don't know if that's going to be necessarily as powerful, let alone if they're even going to try it. And yeah, you see Dazzle right here immediately being ran down. He's in trouble.
He's dead. He's so dead.
Axe, can he maybe save the day? Absolutely not. Nothing he can do. We got the counter helix first, so he's just relying on RNG right there. And that's an easy kill. So yeah, I was going to say, it seems like this is a awkward decision, unless they were planning on creep cutting or something.
Yeah, it's one of those things, though, you need 2 before you can really do that, because then you get call and spin, you get grave and heal, or poison touch and heal. They really need that level 2 before they could try to do much in this. I think the axe would have been a lot better served just jungling off the safer side of this jungle here.
Flo, he's not dead right here. I mean, Dazzle's coming in, but that's a lot of damage coming out. It's going to force maybe the shrine even. He's limping on over too. He doesn't want to waste anymore. He doesn't have a salve or anything like that, so...
He would have died without the poor man's.
Oh yeah, no, he was being run down. I'm a little surprised Juggernaut today. I think Juggernaut kind of felt like they weren't gonna get the kill, but honestly, if he joined them with a spin, like that was another kill probably on Axe right there. So, but he lets the supports do his thing. He wants to farm up the creep wave in the meantime, and Dazzle again is just gonna be found by Tusk and kind of boxed out right here. So really proven to be a very difficult laning phase all around. We mentioned already the matchup with Venno versus TA, and I'm sure that's gonna look good for Venno eventually, although Tia is actually doing decent at the beginning. Now, Venno probably needs a couple of levels here.
Oh, absolutely. He definitely needs more levels. And with the build he's going, this Veil Poison Sting build, it really just explodes out. Like, I wouldn't be surprised to see him take his ult here right at 6 if he gets some extra items to up his mana pool, like even just treads.
Yeah.
Because you can just kill the TA right at 6. You just Gale right-click an R and TA dies.
Nothing that she could do other than maybe try to go for the turn kill, but likely that's going to happen before you die is pretty unlikely. So, yeah.
And while Jug could have gotten that kill if he came up with spin, there's a couple problems with that. You lose out on one or two waves of farm and experience, so you fall a little behind the enemy safe lane and experience there. And when the supports are zoning this Axis effectively, you've kept him level 1 at 3 minutes. So he wants to just spread that XP differential to keep the kill potential up longer.
Yeah.
I really disagree with Mikey's choice, though, to go jungle at level 1. I think he could have double Ion Shelled the wave, and there wasn't a lot Bloodseeker Slardar could have done. Instead, now he's not super ahead in this lane. Like, he took a lot of time to go jungle.
Yeah, and it's not like this is a surprising lane. The fact that he had, you pretty much were guaranteed at least it was going to be the Bloodseeker. I mean, it could have been a Dazzle, of course, maybe kind of zoning him out a little bit. But even that, as you mentioned, with the double Ion Shell, ideally that would have pushed it up quite a bit, got some efficient farm, and harassed Bloodseeker on top of that, so it is an odd decision here, but he's going to have some support coming in as here comes the roam as Tusk and Rubick making their way over. This Slardar, he's in for a killing right here.
Xyr's out of mana, though. Doesn't have the Sol Ring quite yet, so he doesn't have another Ion Shell.
Oh, what a land on the Ice Shards, though. Is it enough? Yes, it is. There we go.
Okay, great lift. Great lift from Rubick.
That was good coordination on the side. Again, this is a team formerly known as Going In. Now they're named Penta, but they almost won the open qualifiers the first time around, losing to Pro Dota in the end. And in the second one, they also got pretty deep on top of that. So this is definitely a very solid team here on this side. And they're showing it early on, not only with the draft, but obviously with their play. Up 2-0 here. 4 minutes. We got Skitter at the bottom lane on Juggernaut. He overall is having a great time. Bloodseeker, I will say this, is actually doing very well, though. 30 and 13, and it kind of maybe goes back to the idea that you said from the beginning, or Darkseer chose to jungle rather than harass the Bloodseeker right off the bat, so letting him free farm, essentially.
Yeah. And while that roam did secure a kill, it also gave Axe room. The Axe is now level 3 and stealing camps out of the Radiant jungle, so very nicely done from him to get a little bit of recovery here, but might have been the danger zone now. Okay, yeah, you realize this Tusk's here. Get me out. Get me out.
Don't want to stick around, so he will port out and go get some regen and then back into the jungle, I'm sure. He will go right here. Tusk, he's still trying to find another opportunity. Slaughter is going to spot him first and go after one another, really kind of zoning him out, though. Places a defensive observer ward there. Dazzle's kind of rotated to the middle lane somewhat to protect this TA, but you do see TA still a very slight lead. It's pretty close, Radiant's pretty even at this point. 25-3, 23-5 Venomancer, who does have the level 3 Venomous Gale now, and is going in right here, has that support. Here comes the Snowball, gonna connect right there. No Ice Shards just yet. Dust comes out, so they're not going for the kill on TA. The Refraction does tanker him up a little bit too much. There's the Ice Shards, but gonna whiff right there. Pain on Dazzle. He'll be on the other side. So no kills coming out, but the pressure continues.
I think those shards could have come out a lot faster and they maybe would have gotten a kill on TA.
Yeah.
But opting to hold them a little too long, and this is one of those things, I think somebody on Penta desperately needs a bottle. I'm not sure why they aren't buying one, but this turn is going to be very dangerous.
Yeah, Blazemon keeps on running with that Rupture. It's one of those awkward situations. It's like, does he stand still and die because they're going to just collapse on him, or does he run and try to maybe get to the Shrine? But it was just too much damage, and the Shrine was on cooldown, actually. That wasn't going to matter in itself. So, yeah, very awkward decision making right there, and he ends up going down as a result. So how about that rotation? All of a sudden, 2-0 in that fight, and we're tied at 2 apiece.
Yeah, look how close Venno is to 6. Why are they ganking that lane when he's one wave from being able just to ult and make that fight totally different? For the twin. It's just kind of weird timings here out of Penta, and Zoken really punishing that.
So I'm not going to suggest that Venomancer is the most difficult hero. He's not like up there with one of these, you know, micro heavy heroes by any means. But at the same time, they're kind of going to what you're just suggesting right there. It kind of makes me wonder, you know, is this them reacting to seeing it so much in the Chinese scene over these last couple of days? They're like, hey, that looks pretty good. Let's try it ourselves. How much experience does Blazemon have on it, though? I mean, that's another curious question. And, you know, kind of going to what you're saying as a team where he wasn't even level 6, so he didn't have the Poison Nova. That's pretty strong and going to ideally guarantee that kill if he has that right there. So, yeah, not necessarily knowing the timings just yet.
Yeah, no, that is really one of the questions, because they probably haven't had a lot of scrims in the last couple days. And to be able to run something totally new and off the wall like this, yeah, you're right. I mean, he may have played it in some pub games, but how much competitive experience does he have on it?
Well, again, this is a best of three, so you know, they're kind of giving it a shot here, at least in game number one. And to be fair, it's obviously a, you know, pretty back and forth game right now. It's not like a snowballing out of control, but this Bloodseeker is getting pretty deadly. And I know you're mentioning off the bat there, you know, curious what we're going to see from him, especially being in that one position. He's sitting on 1,600 gold right now with nothing queued up. So, dare I say Radiance? No, probably not.
But. No, but that would be really cool.
Let's get that straight up Radiance right here and just run down enemies.
I mean, we saw an Abaddon do it the other day. What's to say a Bloodseeker can't?
Yeah, right? It's like a little pub style build right here. But, I mean, no, he still has nothing queued up. Either he's just keeping information or he's still undecided, even himself, so. We'll see what he ends up getting. I mean, he is having a free farm. Do you think even something like a Hand of Midas could work right here just to go extra greedy, or is that unnecessary?
It seems a little too greedy, but then again, if it kind of goes both ways. If he buys real items, I think they pressure Penta a lot. And if you pressure Penta a lot, Penta's really in trouble. So I wouldn't like to see it. I think it's not even necessarily that it's too greedy in the late game, because I think their lineup scales fine. But I think they lose too much.
Wow.
That Omni Slash effect on the Arcana is so cool.
Yeah, and he just ran him down too. That was a Surge mixed with the Phase Boots. Bloodseeker, by the time he sees that Juggernaut just going full throttle at him, that Omni Slash is already coming out, and a sweet animation on top of it. Obviously the Snowball follow-up and sets up the easy kills. So much for that free farming Bloodseeker. Finally they address him, and not only that, but Juggernaut is the one involved to get the kill right there as well. So good rotation from Penta.
Yeah, very nice rotation. I love seeing teams that use Omni Slash prop like the second it's up.
Yeah.
You don't see enough teams anymore rotating the jug right away and getting the burst while it still hurts. Omni Slash is definitely one of those abilities that has this period right at like 6 to 8 where it's a kill. And then it's got that lull until Judd gets an item or two where it's not as scary. So, good use of them to get a solid kill out and on the Bloodseeker as well. So, nicely done from Penta for the rotation.
Bloodseeker does have that Yasha queued up now. So, but it I think it was you that we were talking about this the other day, how people were kind of sitting on gold for so long. Kind of a pet peeve of mine. It's not like yours as well. And you know, the case of Bloodseeker right here, sure, maybe he just didn't know exactly what he wanted to go for, but man, he was missing out on some stats right there that he definitely could have had, let alone the Blade of Alacrity. I'm not saying that would have saved him, but you know, a little bit more farm potential, a little quicker kills on the creeps, and who knows, right? So just seems a little silly.
Yeah, at the very least, he could have rushed the Blade of Alacrity out. That 10 agility, not that it probably would have mattered for the Jug Gank, but it does add an armor and a half. Maybe could have been the difference, but I mean, I guess we'll never know. But yeah, teams have been sitting on gold a lot in this, and it has definitely been upsetting. TA with 2,200 gold, I'm assuming, is waiting on the Blink Dagger, so that's probably forgivable. But
that makes sense, of course. Yeah, if you plan to get that big item, obviously, of course. But not queuing up items in general on Zoken Gaming's side. They're keeping information, man, from us as spectators. How dare they? There's that Blink Dagger, though. Picked up on TA and top lane. Darkseer is still pushing in. Level 4 Iron Shell. He's going to keep his distance, though, as there's four players up here again. Bottom lane, they are porting in, though. They want to make a play down here now, but I don't know if they're going to get the easy chance, at least. Like Juggernaut playing is somewhat safe. Juggernaut went the Helm of the Dominator, by the way, mm-hmm. So we do see it here. All right.
Yeah, I was going to say, a bit of an odd choice from him, but does end up going that. I just think the Yasha is better now after the nerfs. It just doesn't seem worthwhile to put that much gold into a Dominator.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
I think Jug was definitely one of those heroes that bought it only because it was super effective stat-wise.
Yeah.
And I don't think it is anymore. I really don't.
I don't know. It's just like, again, I guess it kind of depends just how you Dire's ultimately plan to play this game. If they do plan to, like I said, go the group up strategy, you know, get the core item here on Venomancer, which is the Dragonlance, it looks like early on, then maybe push a tower or two and not be afraid to get involved in team fights, then obviously that aura is going to be very helpful. But yeah, there is the argument that as far as being more greedy for yourself, that perhaps that can overall be better for the team, in this case the Juggernaut. Going straight Yasha instead, which we definitely have seen a lot more. The straight Manta style into Diffusal Blade, even vice versa, we've seen quite a bit over the Helm of the Dominator lately. So it players tend to agree with your line of thinking, that's for sure, as of late. So
I will say this is Blazemon's first official game on Venno.
Is it? You were checking that up, yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the case again of, yeah, they saw the Chinese scene doing it, and I mean, it's understandable because, again, it was doing very well over there in a lot of cases. You kind of get it why they wanted to give it a shot, and the matchup made sense, so it's not like it was a bad pick here.
And it's a best of three. In a best of three, you do get flexibility.
Yeah, if this was best of one, yeah, the likelihood we would be seeing it, you know, probably not as likely, but. Hey,
I believe you need to meet. Gamer, I'm gonna start double talking. By the way,
I need a what? Sorry.
In Dota, am I talking twice now?
No, I haven't muted okay. On my end, so.
Perfect. Okay.
So Venomancer though, he is somewhat struggling. He is only fifth in the net worth right now. He's just about to finish the Dragonlance and get it delivered right here. He's been in the middle lane this whole time though. Is that a concern? He hasn't even used his Poison Nova just yet, as we were referring to earlier.
I think it all comes off the back of that clunky gank timing. When that got turned around and they got double killed, going for that right before Venno hit 6, it put him in this weird spot where he doesn't want to leave the lane so that he doesn't fall too far behind the TA, but now he's not getting effective use out of this build. This Poison Nova, Poison Sting, like the skipping wards is meant to gank or take team fights, at the very least just kill the TA. And we haven't seen it line up at any sort of gank timing with the Tusk, so it's just kind of ripple effects from what happened a few minutes ago.
Bottom lane Axe with that Blink Dagger. Looking to set up a kill on a Tusk, perhaps, but not giving them an easy chance. As I say that, he kind of pokes in right there. And again, the Heal Wave Bomb on top of that. He's ready to go. They also bring in Slaughter. There's the follow-up. There's the Heal Bomb. Not doing the most damage initially, but the Golden Blade is going to be set up for an easy kill there. As Slaughter was able to make his way in. No Blink Dagger on Slaughter yet, but of course the Sprint gets in there quickly enough.
Yeah, the Axe has his, which is all you were really hoping for. With how that level 1 started, it looked like it was going to be a struggle for Axe to get there. But good job by the Axe to kind of just jungle and relax. Didn't die at all.
Well, he's also trying to set up another kill in the middle lane. The Rupture going off as well. Skinner forces to stand his ground. Zevin gets credit for the kill right there. They do get the turn kill out of flow. Nice Yellow Grave, but that Poison Nova doing plenty of damage over time. And a port out right there from Bloodseeker. He's going to try to heal up in the fountain. He should be fine. And 7 as well on Templar Assassin. Oh, he gets hit by the Ice Shards right there. The heal coming out. That dot is still up. But it's not going to be enough damage in the long run. He will survive himself, but barely. He needs to get the hell on out of here. They want to chase this. Mikey going in. Cannot catch up, but the Frozen Sigil slowing down Pain a little bit. And Dazzle is out of mana right here, so he probably is going to get picked off. And that will be the end of him. So, but there we go. We see the power of that Poison Nova. They did lose Juggernaut, of course, but everyone just having to run away at the very end there.
Yeah, a little unfortunate to end up losing the Jug there like that, but man, that fight could have been so much better for them. The TA was at 40-something health at one point. The Bloodseeker TP'd out with the Grave and just barely lived. But yeah, that's what Poison Nova does. That's what the skill build does. And now that he's level 12, he was not before that fight on the Venno. If you look at Poison Nova, the scaling on it is actually very, very nice. It does so much damage with every point you put in. And I would not be surprised when these kind of fights happen to see him want to lean towards the Ags. The Ags can really just make or break these fights if they're going to happen a lot, because it brings the cooldown all the way to 60 seconds.
That's insane. Definitely not even want to think about getting even on a core Venno, of course. Bottom lane TMC is going to be cut down as the Culling Blade coming out. TA is the one that started that, though. Did plenty of initial damage to set up that kill. So Tusk finding himself in a back-to-back ganks as well. Trying to work on that Blink Dagger himself.
Here's kind of where the Bloodseeker seems a little out of place. This Zoken lineup right now has your Blink up on Axe, your Blink up on TA. This is when they want to find pickoffs and they want to get a lead. They're probably not pushing a ton of objectives right now. They're probably just taking these 2-on-2 skirmishes or better if they can find them. But generally, when you do this, you want a really big carry farming up to get big and kind of secure your late game. Instead, they have a Bloodseeker. So I'm not sure quite how this is going to work out in the long term, but they are going to go for a five-man smoke, I'm assuming, into the Roshan pit.
Yeah, they're heading there. The defensive weave already coming out, and they are going to do Roshan, and boy, are they going to do it fast. That's going to be a very sneaky and easy Roshan kill. That's Aegis on who, actually? TA or the... Let's see, it is going to be TA here. Kind of goes back to that. Yeah, that could have gone either way. I mean, neither one of those, again, are that really scary, scaling carry necessarily. Right now, TA, I guess, just being more involved at this point, so...
Yeah, TA scales in the fact that if she's an item ahead, she's super scary. Like, if a TA is running at you and you know she's bigger, then you kind of just die because she hurts a lot. And definitely has a huge lead. We're seeing 1,600 net worth ahead of the Jug, almost 1,700 above the Venno. So definitely in that strong power position right now, and as long as the farm and kills keep going, she'll be scary for a while.
What's Dazzle doing? Is he trying to pick up the courier this whole time? No. He's just kind of chilling here. I mean, he's had TP off cooldown for a while, and I mean, he already got his ward down, actually, back here. So, yeah, he's finally going to be TP now.
This is a tactical thing. I believe it was coined by PPD called the Welfare Dazzle, where you're so broke that you just don't care if you die.
All right.
Good strategy. And he has 1,100 net worth at 18 minutes. He's bought every single ward in this game. Every smoke, literally everything of any use, and... It really does make it so it just doesn't really matter if he does get caught. So you can kind of be a mobile ward if you don't think you're going to be needed. But this Helm of Dom is being used effectively by the Juggernaut. Grabs one of these Alpha Wolves for pushing. And they're trying to make Zoken come up and answer. They know they have the stronger 5v5 right now with the Darkseer Vacuum and the Wall and the Gale. So they want Zoken to come fight them. And Zoken's going to have to.
Yeah, they're coming in. TA starts the way. They're going to deny the tower if they really want to right here. Tower is under attack. I assume they are. Yeah, there we go. They deny the tower, and they will ultimately hold the push. But again, the tower still falls, so Penta, minor victory right there that they can be satisfied with. And now Juggernaut pushes the bottom lane and looking to continue his farm as far as the Manta-style finish right here. So... Gonna finish that as he's pushing out the bottom lane. Middle lane, though, gonna be counter pushed by Zoken. Meanwhile, Bloodseeker is here, ready to go. Does have that blood right. A huge silence coming into play. Gotta be careful with that. Tusk the ice shard. See Pain. Dazzle's like, I don't really care. He's gonna kind of walk it off. Throwing out a mini heal. He does have that level 4 Shallow Grave. That's kind of the key tool in these fights. We saw it last fight to help save the Bloodseeker, I think it was. Especially against the likes of Venomancer with all that life ticking down, so. Now they're not going to go for it at full throttle, but it will be denied on the tower. So again, in case now the minor victory for Zoken as they get that. Double damage on TA with the Desolator. Yeah, you got to be careful.
Yeah, that's terrifying. That'll two-shot pretty much anyone but the Darkseer.
Back to farm she goes. The Blink Dagger. Darkseer finishes on himself, so... He's got kind of his core here, the mech, the Arcane Boots, the Blink Dagger. Guardian Greaves eventually to come, you'd think, but... Not here just yet. Wants to prioritize getting that vacuum wall combo, which you also really haven't seen yet. So, I mean, there is a bit of wombo combo here on the side of Penta Sports, but again, we really haven't seen anything line up just yet. We've only seen the Poison Oba once in general on the wall. I don't think we've seen at all on top of that. So, it feels like, yeah, that's kind of hurting Penta a little bit, despite maybe they just haven't had the opportunity, to be fair. But TA. He's got
Just haven't had these nice little clean team fights. Penta wants to just keep pushing these T2s. They want to be his five. They want to keep forcing fights. So I guess to be careful.
Yeah, they want this kill, but Seven's not going to dive too much. He'll be satisfied with a Tusk kill, and that's a two-shot right there. Yeah, that's a Desolator, the Meld combo coming in. It's just so much damage. And Tusk kill
really
again. And Juggernaut's kind of being boxed out by Slaughter, so they're going to push this bottom tier too. We kind of talk about the strength of team fight here. It feels like Penta arguably has the better team fight, but
they've got to find a way to get into the fight, though. Like, right now, this is less of a team fight and more how can you kill the raid boss, Oak? And, like, this TA is so big, and it's kind of just one boss with a bunch of support because you've got Grave, you've got Axe Call, and Crushed Peel. And then you've still got Blood Rage on this TA, making it do 40% more damage. So it's so hard to bring that down. So if Zoken gets to set up and position how they want, It's not that their team fight's better, it's that Penta can't take their team fight.
Yeah, so again, they're kind of controlling the map right now, and then that is very evident. Going back to the point you're bringing up earlier, though, it does seem like this Bloodseeker is 1-1-2 at 22 minutes into the game, and that's because of the lack of really any engagements at all. Like, he's, again, talk about lack of using abilities. He's only used his Rupture once, I can recall. And that was in that middle fight that took place to help kill the Juggernaut, I believe it was. So it's both sides. I mean, there's a lot of avoiding going on. I think that's more on Penta, again, doing the avoiding as you're getting at right there. But at 22 and a half minutes, only 5 to 6 hero kills when we have heroes like a TA, like a Bloodseeker. It just seems off. It seems off right now with the pace of the game. But both teams, they're playing it pretty safe somewhat. So,
yeah, he used it twice. He used it to kill or pressure out the Venno when they overextended on that dive too in middle.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah. Level five on the Venno. But yeah, this is what I mean. This game's gonna come down to this dance. You've got a little dance between vision and positioning and overall map movement. Because the team fight's way better for Penta, that's not even debatable, but it's gotta be their team fight. So they're gonna fight over vision and making sure they know where everyone is on both teams.
Payne's just been running away this whole time. He actually will survive. Again, the fact that he lives, though, is actually kind of just crazy in itself because he's only on brown boots and a magic wand. That's it. He got
that
some
wasn't
support.
That wasn't even the Venom ult, though. That was just Q and a right click.
It was. Oh, they missed Crush, but it's not going to matter. Here comes the wall comber from Mikey, but is there the follow-up? It doesn't look like it. The rest of the team is falling back, and thus Zoken will be fine. So now that's the vacuum wall combo on cooldown.
It was a great back wall, but you can't fight around the shrine with a Venno.
True.
If he poison Nova's that, and then they pop the shrine, that fight goes terribly for Penta.
Apparently that's not going to stop them from going back in, though. Omni Slash, he finds Baba right there on the slaughter, kind of by himself, poking in, and that's a free kill as a result, so get something. Oh, the Ice Shards catches Pain, and he's going to feel the pain now. He's going to delay it, TP. No, it's not going to work. He'll be killed off here. Throws out a weave just because Jabs actually was picked off elsewhere. Looks like TA getting an eye for an eye right there as he takes out their own support. Kind of makes
and
him
Hurricane great. Pike is so fun to watch on TA once TA is this scary, because if he's ever in Pike range, she just Hurricane Pikes you and then kills you from across the map. Like, those four autos will kill anybody except Darkseer, unless the mech comes in, so we'll have to see if we get any cool, like, 2,000 range right-click shenanigans.
Yeah.
And they do have the ability to do that with the Corrosive Haze. That's going to keep vision, so if you pike someone away into fog, you don't actually lose the vision and then just blow them up. That's look at this net worth, though. The TA is so scary.
That's pretty high up there. 15, nearly 16,000. That's almost upwards of about a 4,500 lead or so over the Juggernaut on the other side. Definitely doing very well. As you mentioned, the Hurricane Pike, and yeah, she almost has a BKB finish. In fact, 300 more gold or so, and she's going to have that BKB as
yeah,
well.
Yeah, if all I saw was net worths and no hero portraits, I'd think this was an alchemist. This is insane. And a lot of that comes down to the fact that TA effectively farmed Ancients. A lot of people have kind of forgone stacking Ancients and that sort of thing anymore since the nerf to the jungle where they only respawn every 2 minutes. But in reality, we're seeing what can happen if they're stacked effectively and used, because she took Ancients very early on, level 7 or level 8.
Those side blades there, allowing her to do so. And some nice team support. So a couple of key items coming out on the other side for Penta. There's a Blink Dagger on Juggernaut. A little more mobility now to catch people with that Omni Slash, put himself in a blade fury position. And then the Darkseer does finish his Guardian Greave, so another nice tool to have. But on the other side, Bloodseeker has a Diffusal Blade. We talked about the BKB just finished on TA, and Bloodseeker actually has his own BKB now coming along with 2,000 gold saved up, so he too is getting there pretty nicely. 7 will pick up the Aegis. He's going to run away right here. Don't think that they're going to be jumping him, because that would be bad timing.
This is the result of that vision control game. The only ward Radiant has up right now is the one that they just placed 10 seconds ago. And when you don't have vision of where the Dire team is, you're scared to move. And you always have to wonder if they're doing Rosh, but they take it so fast. The Soken team just shreds Rosh on. So getting beat out in the ward game, and it's echoing through this entire game right now.
I mean, Soken probably They don't have to, but yeah, I was going to say, like, they should be confident enough now to be pushing towers here. They're going to do that. The BKB, the Aegis on TA is the biggest thing. You see that Blood Rage going up on him as well, so not really afraid of too much here. And thus the easy tower kill. Top lane is being split pushed by Juggernaut, actually putting some pressure on the Tier 3 tower up there. So doing a good job of being a distraction at least, and is going to force Zoken to fall back, at least for the time being. But that Blink Dagger on Skitter has definitely proven to be an efficient pickup, if he's going to be going this route especially. Of the split push, that is.
So. Yeah, it really will. I don't like the Jug Blink pickup here. I think they have plenty of ways to get in the team fights. He already went a Helm of Dom, which is not really a damage, like a battle item necessarily. It's more of a, I'm going to dominate a creep and push buildings kind of thing. And I really don't think he's going to be doing nearly enough on this Jug for them in these team fights.
And he has a Lincoln Sphere queued up. Yeah, top it
this
off.
Is like
so.
Super defensive.
Yeah. Yeah, no, that means that they're really relying on the Venomancer to be. And again, he will, as long as he gets good positioning with that Poison Nova, like, it's going to do a lot of damage, to be fair. And so, do they really need Juggernaut dealing, you know, being this heavy hitter when you have a Venomancer threat in the game? I guess that's.
But how is the Venno ever going to get a decent ult off at this point? He's got a Hurricane Pike, so sure, he can pike in an ult. But then the Maelstrom does nothing because he's going to get two-shot as soon as that ult comes out.
Maybe we're going to see an opportunity right here. Seven's going to be jumped. Walrus pump initiation. There's Blow right in the background as Meemo the Wall combo comes off with the Omni Slash bouncing around. Painy actually Shallow Graves himself so far. Nobody dead. And Juggernaut's completely away from his teammate. Zoken, actually Bloodseeker right here. He's the one that's trying to run him down. There's a turn kill. That's what I was saying, though. Juggernaut completely overstepping his boundaries right there just to chase. And that
Radiant
was a wrong
detection.
Decision. Do they not? He was sitting on that meld, wasn't he?
Yeah, he was just sitting in there, totally alone, and Penta couldn't find him.
Oh, you're right. Right now, at least, yeah, there's nothing in their inventory that has detection at all, and that's a mistake.
That is inexcusable.
Yeah.
That should have been the Aegis and the TA kill with the way the Jug positioned in that. Yeah, Jug was going to die there, but getting the Aegis for free and then killing this TA would have made this all worth it. Good Hurricane Pike.
Yeah, well, nice throw in the air at least. Now TA, he may not fall in, but again, the Aegis is going to bring him up if he does. There we go. In fact, they're probably just satisfied with that. Bao is going to be picked off, though the Walrus Punch on him. There's a Resurrection, though, on TA. And I'm still looking for that Vision. It's still okay, they do have Sentries now on Rubick. So he would be able to place him if the Meld does come out here, trying to keep himself alive. But are they going to keep going on this? It looks like Zoken is pretty confident, despite now the Aegis being used. They get the tower kill. This is a tier 1 tower. I mean, this is a lot of fighting for this. And now here's a jump in from Tusk. The counter Berserker's call. They're getting low on TA, but there comes a Shallow Grave. He pops the BKB after now. And now Blazemon, nice surge on him to help keep the distance, trying to survive. Mikey in the background will finish off TA, but Bloodseeker gets the kill on a Venomancer. Now he's going for the TP. Yes, it will be in time. Makes his way out, but well, Penta, I mean, that's not too bad of a result, I feel like. It's only a tier 1 tower, after all.
Yeah, overall, they're pretty content with that. The Bloodseeker definitely should have died there. Again, we're seeing maybe some nerves come out, because the Rubick should have had the mana for the Telekinesis to stop the Bloodseeker TP there. He had a 2-charge stick that would have given it to him. The Arcane Boots were up on Mikey on the Darkseer. Just some little missteps resulting in some missed gains for them. But yeah, all in all, they'll be very happy to bring down that TA for a little while.
Yeah.
Look at her gold, though. That's 3K sitting in the bank.
Oh, boy. Maybe she's going for a Sacred Relic. That's possible.
Yep, Rapier TA. Let's see it.
Seems like the appropriate time, right, to be picking that up?
Yeah, I feel like you're firmly in control of the game. Go buy a Rapier in every one of your pubs for anyone watching.
Yeah.
If you have a lead, just buy it. It's perfect. It's
so
never going to cause any problems.
So good. No, it's, yeah, don't know what she's gonna. Okay, well, there we go. Now she has something queued up, and, yeah, it's a case like that, too. It's like, ugh. It's Orchid is one of these items, too. The build-up's actually fantastic, and each of those items that it creates here, the quarterstaff, the Sage's Mask, and the Robe of the Magi, you know, you're looking at, it's a decent stat build-up, as well as the attack speed increase, so, yeah, it doesn't feel like there's an excuse for sitting on so much gold, but she is. And we're going to be looking to right-click the full item eventually. Right here. We'll see how that works. Oh, bottom lane chase is happening down here, by the way, as they do catch Blazemon. He's dead for 70 seconds now with no buyback. Obviously pretty key right here. Omni Slash coming out, but there's a lot of creeps nearby. Bloodsinger pops the BKB. The Shallow Creep coming out. He's going to TP. So he's going to run, actually, while his teammates are coming down. A little curious about that, but the Berserker's called the back on only catching the one. The wall comes out. Not really the greatest, though. More of a zoning wall. Skidder once again, though. He's pushed out pretty far without his teammates. Walrus Punch on a TA, though. Skidder wants this kill. It's going to come at a cost. He can't get the kill because of the Shallow Grave. And down goes Juggernaut. The greed is real on the side of Soken. And now he doesn't have a buyback. Wait, he had a buyback, and now he doesn't. He bought two Blades of Alacrity?
Mm-hmm.
So I guess they're content on not buying back here. Okay.
Yeah, and they can definitely get punished for this. This is should be a barracks. You don't have wall. You don't even have Venowalt when he rezzes. There's nothing for Zoken to be scared of right now.
I'm honestly shocked that he bought those items after death right there to not give himself buyback. Because, yeah, with Veno coming up, I mean, sure, no ultimate just yet, but... is that even enough to scare them without the Juggernaut being here? And it's probably not. Tusk is going to fall. There's a Bloodrite coming out of this tier 3 towers now. At least going to die and possibly more. Blazemon doing what he can. The Poison Nova's up in 15 seconds right here.
Holy TA almost dodged by blinking through the Minnow. That would have been really cool.
Blazemon, he's dead. He gets picked off right there really easily. Down goes Rubick.
Hit buildings!
This could be the beginning of the end right here. Yeah, I'm getting a little distracted with hero kills, but they're getting them to be fair. And now the racks are going to be focused. And that's bottom rack. So all of that transition into bottom racks. And then there's the argument, it's like, if Juggernaut doesn't have buyback, like, why are you even trying to commit towards... I mean, it's not like they were overextended to be fair, I guess, but... yeah, they get
picked Rupture
off.
Was still up. Rupture caught the Veno. So then he kind of had to commit into the fight.
And now what is Skidder doing? This is almost a bit of tilt, it feels like, on the side of going into Cave Penta right here. He's going to pop the Omni Slash. He did get the kill on TA, actually. So maybe there is something going to this. Bloodseeker going to barely survive. He runs through the wall with that BKB, and he will be able to get away. Slaughter is going to be picked off. And okay, double kill for Juggernaut. He was pretty low there for a second, but he actually does make his way out. Oh, no. Das, oh, the crush at the last second.
Poor
they
guy.
Him. All right, so... he gets a triple kill on Juggernaut. All right, so there's something.
Wow, almost an instant Roche respawn. Yeah, so if Penta does acknowledge this is the opening of the Roshan timer and checks it right the second, still in an okay position, not great, but if they could grab this Roche, because Dire is going to secure every Roshan that they're able to, maybe a glimmer of hope. But what the Jug was trying to do, he made the executive decision that if he bought those Blades of Alacrity before his death, he had the defusal, but he didn't quite get it off, lost the gold, and was just a little bit short of the defusal blade coming into that fight.
Yeah. And now here's that Roshan kill in favor of Penta with the cheese. So it seemed like it was just going to be almost a GG moment for Zoken, and now Penta, maybe they have a chance right here, kind of an all-in idea. They're going to get Roshan 100%. They thought about maybe trying to protect it, but with TA still being dead, not worth the risk. There we go, the Aegis pickup. Cheese picked up by Venomancer. And the levels are adding up, too. I mean, Juggernaut's level 23. Veno, he's level 21. And Veno's pretty important, too, because that level 25 talent, the minus 60-second respawn time. You know, he's kind of that bomb where he gets his ult off, he's kind of done his job, and then even if he dies, he's up in like 40 seconds, if not less. So,
We'll have to see if that's what he opts for. The Plague Ward talent's pretty insane, though, I'm not going to lie.
It is, but I've seen, like, 5 Veno games now, and all have gone the minus 60-second respawn, mm-hmm. whatever it's called.
I think so, when you go this carry build, you have to.
Yeah.
If you were going a more utility build with an Ags or a Blink or something, maybe it changes. But the one thing I can say is I think we're seeing a little bit of Blaze not playing this Veno, because I don't think this build was the proper build path for this game. There's so many ways for this Dire team to just... run you down so you can't kite away, which is what a Veno wants to do. Good Rubick lift.
Now, again, the offensive Omni Slash here from Skidder. He's not been afraid to do that. He's jumping in and popping Omni Slash, despite the creep not being around.
Mikey bought back for no reason.
Well, maybe to push.
I guess.
All in push here.
It kind of feels that way. I do feel like there's a little bit of anger going on in the team chat for Penta right now.
It does, doesn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, it's one of those games that just feels like they're like, oh, we got to kill, go, 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 go. It's time to end the game, and they're just kind of running it at Zoken here.
Yeah, some of the decision-making has seemed a little off here on the side of Penta, but you know what? They still have a chance. Again, with the Aegis, with the Cheese Dust coming out, they're going to spot 7 right there. Here come the crits from Skidder jumping in, gets a Bash proc. Over the Hurricane Pike away. He's going to sit in that meld again, and there's a Blink Dagger to escape. Skidder himself needs to be careful. Again, he does have the Aegis, I guess, so not really too scared about dying.
Why is it so hard for Penta to carry detection? Their only detection is one sentry on Rubick.
They did have Dust, to be fair. Tusk did use Dust from the beginning there.
Okay.
So they did have it. He doesn't have any more, of course. But oh, Rupture onto Juggernaut. He's going to stand his ground, though, but has to take some auto-attack. Got to be careful about that. Another Omni-Slash coming out. 7 pops the BKB, though, standing his ground and putting it into the zone. The Psyblade attacks right here. Bloodseeker getting low. Nice Shallow Grave, though. Going to keep alive for the time being. They do get the Aegis pop on Juggernaut, and Darkseer also picked off. The wall is in a pretty good spot, kind of causing some issue. TA himself is starting to drop, though, and TA will go down with no buyback now. Flo's in trouble on Axe, and Axe most likely going to get picked up. He does have a buyback, though. They do lose Venomancer, Rubick, and Darkseer. So it's only 2 men up. Make that, well, it's still 2 men up as kind of an illusion assisting right there. So now it's 2v2, and another Omni Slash coming out. I thought he just used it, actually. I guess not. It was just illusion attack, so.
It was on cooldown that whole fight until then. Yeah.
Bloodseeker will survive because of the Shallow Grave, though. Double kill for Skidder, and now Dazzle's going to remain dead at this point. So, the Juggernaut, aggressive play. It's paying off here.
So can overextend it. They don't have buybacks. The TA opted to finish off the Bloodthorn.
There's a buyback on Slaughter. So, TA, though, dead for 40 seconds. That is going to be enough to scare them off, however. Maybe. They want to reset. They realize it was just Slaughter, so maybe they're thinking twice about this now. Going back in. Yeah. Blood right. Juggernaut's going to be caught by that. Is silenced here.
Rupture's back up, too.
Oh, there we go. Going to be used. And now Tusk, he's the one that's probably going to fall as a result. Yeah, so Juggernaut gets out, but at least they get the pick on a Tusk. And they do ultimately hold right there.
So, interesting Bloodseeker fact. Rupture, obviously when you port to base, you're moving a lot of units, but it doesn't kill you instantly. Blink Dagger, if you blink, does do Rupture damage based on how far you blink. But the trigger in the game is 1,300 units, which is basically Quap Blink. So if you do a max distance Quap Blink, you actually don't take Rupture damage. It's the only blink in the game that'll make you take zero from it.
Oh, huh. That is curious right there. Mikey gets picked off, by the way. Jabs is trying to make something a play right happen right here, but yeah, he has another Rupture, he has that Ag, so he's got the charges up, and that's a dead Rubick now with a buyback, but still in the background. Oh, TA got caught! Didn't even realize that she was up
again
there. Yeah, this is such a chaotic game all of a sudden. Babao now trying to survive on Slaughter, probably not going to happen, the Glimmer Cape on him, but nice four staff over the ledge. There we go with the TP with the Shallow Grave, and no, not going to work. Double kill for Juggernaut. Yeah. What a finish here.
His actual Abyssal's up. I thought it was just Basher, and he got the first hit Bash there. Super close.
The buyback's not afraid to be used right here. You kind of have the buyback status up, and obviously TA and Tusk staying dead.
Yeah, TA was not expecting to not get at least one kill in that fight. If she'd gotten one kill, the buyback would be online. Instead, doesn't have it yet again. 40 seconds that the Radiant team can look to posture up and maybe take this mid to 3 finally.
Juggernaut has plus 20 agility now because of being level 25. Bloodseeker on the other side, minus 7 second Bloodrite cooldown. Puts it down to 6 seconds, so that's pretty strong. It can essentially have full uptime in theory at this point. So I can see why he went that.
Yeah, and with two different forms of initiation between the Axe Call and the Slaughter Crush, there's real chances he's going to hit 2-3 man silences.
Yeah. Now he is passing up 30% lifesteal to go for that.
I don't think he cares. Yeah. With this Ags, he has double rupture. If you can make him stand in that silence, look at like the lack of BKBs on this Radiant team. Venno doesn't have one. Jug only has spin.
Yeah, they just
aren't.
They are building a Lotus Orb on Darkseer right here. So that'll help a little bit, I guess, but
One of the worst feelings in the world is getting ruptured when you're a Bloodseeker because you run so fast that you just, like, kill yourself right as you notice it.
Yeah. I've noticed that about Rupture with Bloodseeker and Dota here. They don't make the animation very obvious. It's honestly more of a sound cue, if anything, I think you pick up on.
So, yeah, no, I'd agree. There could be easier ways to see the debuffs, but we'll have to see if that Lotus gets used effectively or not.
Yeah.
But this is kind of getting into the territory. Like, Jugs had this Lincolns in this quick buy forever. I'm very glad he went for the Abyssal instead.
That's true.
And I understand the merits of the Lincolns, but with the Ags up on Bloodseeker, you're just going to get double ruptured. One breaks it, the other one kills you. So, I'm not sure if that's really the most effective item choice for him here. Something like a Butterfly feels like it would be a lot better. Yes, you could still die to that Bloodthorn, giving the True Strike, but maybe you just have to save your spin for that.
Or the twins.
Like, you can't spin out of it, but you can Manta and then spin. Because Manta would break the Bloodthorn effect.
So there you go. That logic there. The experience is basically back to even right now. Not that that matters too much at this point in the game, but net worth.
And the net worth. Jug caught up.
He definitely has. Yeah, individually. Yeah, he's up there with both the Bloodseeker and the TA. Venno's still a little bit behind. Definitely been noticeable, but he's trying. Now, you were talking about that earlier, though, as the fight was breaking up bottom lane, I think it was. And the build of Venomancer, I think it just goes back to, though, like, this is what we saw recently. This style of build is what we saw. I mean, I agree with you, that idea more of the team fight, maybe the Ags even, and kind of revolving around your spell ability rather than your right click could have made more sense, but going for the right click style.
Yeah, he is. And the Lincolns is all but done here. I'm imagining he's going to save for buyback, so it'll be a few minutes before that comes out. But he needs a blink. Like, that's the one thing I will say he probably needs most. Because he needs to be able to get a good blink ult off in the fight. I don't care if it's Aghs or not. It's still a core piece to you winning a team fight right now. And he's holding this level 25 talent, which I don't mind. But he needs to make sure he quick skills it before he dies then. Okay, taking the plague wards.
I was going to say, because they're down two sets of racks and this is a game they're fighting to win right now, like, it's gonna be tough. Like, you can argue, I guess, just a plague ward army in the base is gonna be very difficult to try to finish the game again, so maybe there's that logic.
It could be that way. It works so much better for sieging, though. When you're on the offensive throwing those plague wards down, 1500 HP plague wards that have magic immunity are hard to deal with. Good Omni Slash.
That's TA.
He's dead.
Okay, he does have a buyback.
My Venom. Finally.
Yeah, and the last two, Jesse, hasn't had a buyback, so that was scary there for a second, but
I also want to point out he could have had his boots of travel and still had buyback if he bought it before he died. Because he didn't spend his gold efficiently. Again.
Something to think about, yeah.
Alright,
well, he's dead, and he has the buyback option, probably. Again, it's only one Rax right here, so maybe not overall crazy concern, but
getting the Fortify is a big deal. Fortify being down at this point in the game is definitely something serious. Penta, though, needs a gem. It is way too late in the game to not have one. Against the TA, it's the chance of being able to pick them and catch the TA without having to worry about detection. And the biggest thing is traps. They haven't been able to stop this TA from trapping anything she wants pretty much all game.
Yeah. Rubick, I'm also noticing that she doesn't have a detection on them currently. Yeah, there's detection coming in the courier, but they do not have detection on them at all at this exact moment, so he'll have the Sentry Watch coming, but it doesn't look like they're going to even be able to push in too much right here. Descending the illusions constantly, but the Rax will survive despite not having TA. And no buyback even needed to be used right there. So, obviously, a very efficient hold coming out the side of Zokin. But Roshan is up. And now here we go. This is what could definitely decide the game right here. Good old fourth Roshan fight coming out.
Yeah, and I think this might be the first Roshan fight we see. Dire's going to look to smoke up here and go on this. Every other one's been taken borderline undetected, but there's a TA trap sitting here.
And it's happening
they don't
quick.
Have a gem for.
It's happening really quick, as you'd expect at this point. They are going to jump in the background. Sonar going for the jump on a Rubick. Zenus at the target, though. Mikey trying to zone them out with the wall. Pops the Shivas as well. Going to be picked up in that snowball. Going in defensively. Seven, though, in the background. It's kind of split fights right here. TA's dealing with the both of them up here. And can he survive himself? It looks like barely putting in the damage in the touch, but no, he's dropping. And Mikey will take him out, so he has a buyback, but they also got the pick on a Dazzle. They did lose Rubik, so 2-for-1 so far, but now Bao Bao's getting caught. Axis on the run. He's not going to get away, though. Flo goes down with the buyback, but now they can reset to the Roshan, finish him off. And there's chance here once again for Penta. Oh, the chase is still continuing, by the way. They're going to catch Bloodseeker. And he goes down with the buyback.
I bow to Penta in their infinite wisdom. Zokin had a gem. They were just waiting to kill them all and steal it. Why spend money when you can just get it from the enemy?
That makes sense.
In reality, that was hyper questionable, but managing to get that, they're going to force major buybacks here out of Zokin. They're going to have to. And this is the lack of scaling in this Bloodseeker, honestly. It's really effective if the enemy has to run away from you, but if they can man up and fight, everything changes.
Yeah, you just think of so many other heroes that if this Bloodseeker was, how this game probably would be easily over right now in favor of Zokin.
Ooh.
Yeah, the initiation right there is going to be countered somewhat, and they're going to catch Tuss. The Rupture's up. He is pretty tanky. He actually got the 700 life talent at level 25, but more than enough damage to pick him off. They're not going to get any more, though, as they get all those buybacks used. So, again, keeping the tab up. That means all the cores now, no buybacks on the side of Zokin.
And yeah. Go ahead.
Well, it doesn't feel like that they should have to be all in, but, I mean, maybe they do. Because, again, if any of those die right now, that could be the game. So, do they just group up and go cutthroat right here, but then they'd be fighting in ages? So, I don't know.
Nah, you want to stall and try to wait until those buybacks are up again. Hopefully no one gets picked off, but you really can't fight this in its current state. It's just too dangerous. One team fight loss is the game at this point.
Again, this is game one here of this best of three series. Obviously, the first best of three here in the Dota 2 Champions League. So no matter what happens here.
Axe's itemization. He's having to backpack Tom Portal scrolls. He just didn't get the snowball he wanted, and it feels really clunky right now to be this Axe. Good job there from the Tusk in that last fight to save the Venno. The Venno had the Aegis, would have gone down once, probably twice, and the Tusk sacrificing his life by snowballing long enough for Venno to Hurricane Pike out.
Keeping an eye on more level 25s. So the fact that Tusk was able to hit 25 so much earlier than other heroes, I'm a little surprised. But I guess, did he get that talent? Yeah, 40% XP gain. Jesus. Yeah. That's right.
Like, Valve realized the XP gain talents were bad and has just buffed them over and over and over until they're like, please take these.
That is pretty hilarious. And definitely seeing it at play right here. I mean, the longer game like this especially, the fact that he was able to get level 25 so quickly is pretty nice.
Rubik's level 15.
Yeah. Been a struggle. Dazzle's not much better on the other side, only 17, but at least Rubik has more farm.
True. Got that 60 going. GPM talent paying off.
Yeah, haven't really been noticing Rubik and stealing abilities this game. There's not that big AoE, stun or anything like that, so it's not as obvious. He's kind of got just smaller abilities. He's taking over throughout these fights.
TA's level 25 talents feel so bad this game. 30-second respawn, so negligible for a carry in the late game. If you die, your buyback's probably getting forced.
Yeah.
And three refraction instances against this team, it's just a damage boost at that point. It's nothing defensive.
That's true. Yeah, not the most sexy level 25s. And so, a game like this where we are getting so many 25s now, it's kind of going over trying to think about that, which side has the better level 25 talents overall. And, I mean, maybe Penta you lean towards.
I think Venno's level 25 is super impactful. Tusk's own support Tusk is also very good. 700 health is huge.
Dire's bottom tower is under that attack. Is a lot for a support, yeah.
I mean, I think if everyone is going to be 25, arguably the best talent out of all of these is Dazzle getting 1 second poison touches.
Radiant's top tower has fallen. Spamming that over and over again, yeah.
Yeah, you just slam it constantly.
A lot of stuns coming out.
And they stack.
Oh, do they? Really? Really? Jesus. Okay. So you could have
It's like this weird interaction. The damage, unless they fixed it. When it first came out, the damage stacked, but the stun didn't. So they could only be affected by one of the dot or like slow and stun debuffs, but the damage would stack, and you could just stack it on for 100 dot damage every time you cast it.
Okay, yeah, no, you could have like a lot on it. Bottom lane, Slaughter is in trouble. He's being chased down. He's probably going to be killed here. He does have a buyback.
An Omni Slash not committed. That was just Blink Abyssal. So big, big teamfight ult still up.
Skitter make his way into the jungle now. Seems like control right here. Penta's feeling pretty comfortable. But the Aegis obviously has worn off by now. There's the buyback on Asada, by the way, because the fight is somewhat committing down here. The wall combo comes off. Now, Juggernaut's not here for immediate time, but he's going to be joining eventually. Tusk gets jumped by Slaughter. The crit coming down from TA. But there's that Omni Slash, and TA's dropping pretty quickly. He's going to stay dead. Remember, he is dead. 110 seconds. Not coming back up. This is not the fight they were looking to commit into. And now Flo, he's on the run. Heard a Rupture going off in the background. Mikey on Darkseer trying to run away. Rupture is on a Juggernaut as well as Darkseer, as they're both just trying to run as much as they can right here. But it's going to be wearing off shortly. And it looks like they will be fine here.
Yeah, healing ward paying off huge. Those double ruptures, when you can make the enemy run so good, and it slowed down the fight, but then they were able just to sit in the healing ward and recover all this, so Penta can keep on going for this really healthy.
Skitter, he goes in and really two shots of the dazzle right there, and now Flo's going to be pulled in. Is this the comeback being finalized here by Penta? It seems like it. No buybacks on three heroes. It's just Bloodseeker and Slaughter. The last chance. Another Rupture coming out. This one on a Tusk. There's a crush on Tusk. They might get the kill on a Tusk at least. Or maybe not. The Walrus Punch turn. Bloodseeker in trouble. Bloodseeker's going to fall. The snowball being used. GG. Well played. The comeback is real for Penta. And they'll take game number one here in this best of three. Zoken, they just simply could not skill enough to finish off after the two sets of racks right there.
That Tusk was great. I love this hero. I hope it's back. It's one of the most fun heroes to cast and watch, and teams have been using it very effectively for something that hasn't been played very much in the last year. Like, we're seeing very, very good use of this Tusk.
Yeah. No, very powerful tools early on in the game, especially. And yeah, even in the late game, though, he's definitely a support that scales very well. And especially with that XP talent, as we saw there, it's one that, you know, he can hit level or the higher levels much sooner in the game than others. So I'm looking at the net worth chart, though. It's insane, just the crazy other way, how it just rapidly changed the other way. And again, you think of that double racks that went down, and you know, we're suggesting how Penta, they almost seem like